leading us through this conference. Brother Buck Treadway, it's been my privilege to be in meetings with him the past couple of years when he has so marvelously ministered to ministers and given us a word of faith that made us willing to get up and go on. And we bring him to this pulpit from Beaumont, Texas. You receive him to the pulpit of the Pentecostals. May God bless you.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
It's wonderful to be here in this conference. It's been good all the way through. Every man, I believe, that got up to bat has hit a home run. Knocked it clear out of the park. Hey, God's good to us.
Yes, He is.
He's a marvelous God. I'm kindly caught in a strange situation here to preach today. I was requested to preach one message by the committee, and then I was requested to preach another one by the committee. And then I was asked if maybe I could put the two together. I think the first one I preached 1 hour and 25 minutes.
Oh Lord.
And the next one I believe I preached 1 hour and 15 minutes. And I think I'm told today to hold it to 55. Minutes.
I think that's what we're saying.
55 minutes. So how do you do two messages that's over 1 hour apiece? Put it on afterburner. Okay. Anyway, I felt like the Lord got my attention this morning at about 4:30. I was sound asleep. And the Lord nudged me, woke me up. Why don't you sit down? I'll read my text in just a minute. Brother Tenney, just a little bit ago, brought up my granddaddy Wise.
Yes, sir.
What little bit I know about the dead in Christ, I wouldn't be surprised if Granddaddy Wise didn't hear those things he said a while ago. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. I know one thing, if he is eavesdropping on this meeting, I hope he turns his hearing aid off. At least till I get into my message. I was a little startled at the way God influenced my thinking this morning of how to do the best I could about putting these two messages together. If you have your Bibles, I'd like to invite you to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter number 3. I love the Mangans. All of these Mangans, I love them. I was standing on this platform last night, and Brother Carol Mangan turned around, and at one point in time he said, when we came here, Anthony was this long. And I remember that. I certainly do remember it. I don't know if it's altogether true, but it's my understanding that Brother Mangan, especially in Louisiana, preached his first revival for my granddaddy Wise in Eurus, Louisiana.
Right.
And he preached his last one in Eurus before he started pastoring. He preached his first one for my granddaddy and preached his last one for my father.
Right.
And he was such a dedicated evangelist, even to that small community, that before He came here to actually accept the pastorate of this church. He finished that revival. And my dad came here and stood in for him, I believe, two Sundays. So I've watched this church grow through the years. I was telling somebody the passion and the enthusiasm and the push for souls that's here, it's been here for those 52 years. It's been right here. I feel that I was highly favored of God and privileged to get to preach in this church when I was an evangelist. Brother Mangan told me, he said, "You won't hear from me." But he said, "I want you here the first Sunday in every January." And I virtually spent the month here in January. And we had great revivals. I've still got some converts here in this church. God's good to us, isn't he? Ecclesiastes chapter number 3 and verse number 1. To everything there is a season and a time, to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get, a time to lose, a time to keep, a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. Let's pray.
Thank you, Lord.
Dear God, in your name, we love you, Lord, and we praise you. We honor you and we magnify your marvelous, wonderful name. Help me, Lord, to forget everything that I need to forget and to remember everything that I need to remember. Give us clarity of communication here today. I pray in the name of the Lord. Amen. Bless you. You may be seated. When the Lord got my attention this morning for finalizing this, my mind immediately went to this passage of Scripture. And when I read it, I didn't find my text. So I don't have a text. I'm from the old school, and I've been taught that if you preach, you need to be a subject and a text preacher. And so I just needed to read a scripture. But there's not a text in the Bible for my message. Is that all right? And I hope Granddaddy Wise turns his hearing aid off now, because I argued with God about what to call these two blended messages. I'm using the title of a country and western song, or at least one of the lines in it, and it dates me. Puts a date on me. I know I look young, and I can't help that.
If you don't want this on your tape, I'll give you another subject. But what I'd like to call this to the audience today is you picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. Now, Granddaddy Wise, don't you listen to that.
Oh, my God.
If that's too carnal for you, there's been some carnal things happened here today. If that's too carnal for you, I'll give you a more sobering subject. I'll call it the most deadly disease of 2002. And we're not talking about AIDS. Solomon is the wisest man by certification and by theological understanding of all times outside of Jesus Christ. Solomon had it. And he alludes to the fact at the top of this chapter 3 that he is going to cover subject matter having to do with every purpose under heaven. And he covers a lot of stuff in those 8 verses I read to you. I heard a man say the other day that the 2 hardest things you'll ever try to do in your life is to climb a fence that's leaning to you. He said the next hardest thing to do is to kiss a woman that's leaning from you. I mean, if you think there might be some truth to that. Of all the information that Solomon covers in this book of wisdom, verses 1 through 8 of chapter 3, every purpose under heaven, he alludes to the fact that it's a time to do it and a time not to do it. A time to love, a time to hate, a time to gather and scatter, a time to build and a time to tear down. But you know what he does not cover? There is never a proper time to quit. So I can't even find a text in the Bible. There is no time that it's ever proper to give up and quit. And that disease has taken a hold of this world. It's a raging, killing disease, and it is highly contagious. I was reading just a few days ago, and it grieved me and made me cry when it said in the last decade, the pastors of the 100 largest Sunday schools in our land, that 25 of that 100 is no longer even in the ministry. They have quit. They took their shingle down and they quit. This generation is diseased with the quits. Everybody wants to quit. I've been a little grieved right here in this meeting. Not at the meeting, but what I left at home. My mind was literally blowed about 2 days before I left to come to this meeting. Two of the finest families I've ever pastored in my life, and they're not new people. They've been there. They're talking about maybe quitting. I'm told that in my community, 52% of the marriages have terminated. Out of every 100 marriages, 52 has called it quits. We're living in the quitting generation. It is a raging disease. And the enemy is using it every way he can. Of all the things I've ever heard old Brother Mahaney preach in my church. How many of you ever heard Big Boy Mahaney? I love to hear his experience, but it seems like almost every time he's in our church, he rages with these words publicly, and I think most times it's just for me. He said there wasn't anybody in the church he prayed through in that ever thought he'd make the grade. I'm going to tell you what, we're still trying to make something out of Charlie. Do you know that? I wonder what old Granddaddy Wise would have done at that Texas youth camp when he came riding down the center aisle on a motorcycle. But Charlie stood in our pulpit the last time he was there, and as loud as he can lift up his voice, he said, "Devil, I want you to know I'm still here." Anywhere. I'm still here. I don't know how to quit, and I don't know how to give up. Hallelujah. We're on a high here in this because of the times. But there's always that enemy that's waiting for you down at the bottom of the mountain. Did you ever notice in the first chapters of Revelation where Jesus addresses all seven of those churches? He found something wrong with every one of them. Every last and one of them, he found things that were unacceptable in that church. But you know what the bottom line was? And I say it like a Southeast Texan. He said, "Buddy, if you'll hang in here, I'm going to save you. Just don't quit. Hang in here. Don't go anywhere. Hold out, and I'll cover you. I'll cover the front, the back. I'll save you before it's all said and done." I don't have much for anybody that quits. You know, I don't even know the words of that song. Probably somebody here could help me. They're all pointing to you, Rex Johnson. Would you come sing it for us? You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. If you was to go with me right now to the 24th chapter of Luke, you find two men that's disillusioned, they're discouraged, they're complaining, they're griping, their life didn't turn out like they thought it should. They were living in the past. We trusted. We believed. We was committed. We walked away from everything. We killed the oxen, burned the plow. We've given everything we had. We understood that you didn't have any place to lay your head. We understood that the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have their nest. And when we followed you with all of that in our mind. And it has all fell apart on us. And they're headed toward Emmaus with a good case of the quits. We're done. Hey, if you ever wanted to walk out on your wife, it's a walking out time. Preachers are walking out too. And if you want to quit, it's a good time to quit. People won't think that much about it. Hey, I was born into a world, John, you and where they thought something about it. We don't think so much about it anymore. It's a common thing to quit. Get another one. Truck on. I was thinking right here in this meeting today. In 1974, I was selected by whoever to come to Manhattan, New York, and I did a New York City crusade in the Manhattan Center. There was quite a crowd of preachers that was a part of that crusade. Brought their choirs, invested their money. We prayed lots of people through. We had great victory. But you know what I was thinking about here in this meeting today? Of all the preachers that was on that committee, I'm one of the lone survivors. All the rest of them have quit. They were officials in this movement. One of them was a missionary that went from church to church, praying all kinds of people through, operating in the gifts. But today, he's quit. We're living in the days when it's popular. It's in the majority where people quit. I was born into a world to where you got you a job. And it was a lifetime career. Here's what some of us pastors are up against. The last thing I read said that every wonderful young couple we've got will move 14 times. They quit one job and go to another job. Hey, I never went to Beaumont, Texas to quit.
I went there to stay. Part of that I learned from this man right here. You don't go in there quitting. You go in there staying. You don't go in there losing. You go in there winning. You've got to anchor down and stay. Stay it out. It's a startling thing to see how people are quitting. Now these guys headed to Emmaus. There was a stranger that just kindly edged his way in to their company. And he said, in so many words, he said, "What are you guys down and out about? Your countenance tells me that you might be diseased with the quits." They said, "We don't know who you are. Where you been keeping yourself?" But he said, one of them said, "Hey, a terrible thing's happened to us. Man, our dreams fell apart. Life didn't turn out like we thought it was. Hey, I thought I was in the ministry. I thought I was. Come find out, I don't know if I am or not." We had somebody that we thought was the Savior. Hey, we had an out front leader. He messed up our minds with this world. We was excited about what we were doing. Hey, we was going to go all the way with Him. You've not heard what happened to Him at the place of the skull. They crucified Him. Jesus plays the game right on with them. They don't even know who it is. He led them right on into their conversation. And here's the clincher. They said, "They crucified Him 3 days ago. And today is the third day." Hey, I knew you wouldn't catch it. Because if you caught it, you'd go crazy. Let's all say it together. Today is the third day. What's going on in your mind? Hey, maybe you should say it again. Today is the third day. It was a day to be happy. It was a day to shout. It was a day of resurrection. It was a day of revival. It was a day to be positive. But they turned it into a day to quit. You know all I've got to say about it? You picked a fine time to leave me, Lucille. What kind of fool can we be? Hearing what we've heard here in this conference, how in the world could anybody think about quitting? How could you think about walking out? Right now's the day of revival. Right now's the day of victory. Right now's the day of miracles. How could anybody quit? Today, you still hadn't caught it. Today, you still hadn't caught it. He said, you look at me. I am he that was dead, but now I'm alive forevermore. Today is still the third day. This is the day of the resurrection. It's a bad day to quit. Terrible day to quit. My. Hey, those men should have been jumping up and down, high as a kite. Couldn't even catch up. They should have been running like Elijah did when he passed up Ahab's chariot. And instead of running, they was mully grubbing it. They was diseased with the quits. Walking in the wrong direction. Sister Mangan, the first time that God allowed me to go to the Holy Land, I got to a mess. 7 miles from where they should have been. And they hoofed it. They walked it. When I got to Emmaus, and all of the Holy Land has been covered up by whoever was in charge. Everybody that's in charge of the Holy Land, they try to block out who had it last. But Emmaus is very authentic. It looks just about, so I was told, like it did even that evening when Jesus was walking with them. And I got there in the cool of the evening. The day was far spent, and the shadows were stretched out, and big old tears began to stream down my face. I thought, my God, here's the place that terminated a wonderful ministry. They had it going their way, but they walked 7 miles to a place of nothing, to a place of emptiness, to a place that's dreamless, to a place with no significance. And every step they took, they were diseased with the quits. It was vibrating through their body. I'm quitting. I'm quitting. I'm quitting. Now I'll get to some of this you wanted me to preach. I was a little, well, I never was really little. But I was a young man in Jonesboro, Louisiana. I was almost out of high school before I even got the Holy Ghost. Sister Mangan's told me time and time again that she would have thought my brother would have preached, but not me. I was quiet, timid, bashful. But I'll never forget one Saturday there in our house. I was in my room and I heard this knocking on the front door. I answered the door, and when I stood there at the door, I was looking into the face of what would probably have been my dad's prize saint. A wonderful, incredible, awesome lady. I don't have the Holy Ghost. I'm just about 15 years old. She said, I need to see your dad. Very, very definitely need to see him. I said, I can probably fix that up for you. Go in there and make yourself comfortable. And right away, I had my mom and dad in the room. And I'll never forget what happened in that room. They didn't know I was listening, but I was. She started this story about how much she loved my dad and respected him, and how much she loved my mom, and how much she loved the church. And that kind of stuff can make you paranoid. It can scare the daylights out of me now when somebody starts telling me how much they love me, because I'm wondering what the buddy is. When they come at you that way, about 99 times out of 100, there's a butt involved. And I'm not talking about the anatomy. But this was a little different, Brother J. Richardson. She went through this process and procedure about her love and devotion and how much she cared. And she said, but what I'm here for. This lady had the most beautiful daughters. Man, I was at the age I'd have given nearly anything if one of those girls would have given me just half a chance. She said, my husband pulls as hard as he can the wrong way. And she said, for years I've pulled as hard as I can the right way. And she said, I'm wore out. And she started crying. And she said, I've come by today to quit. She said, I have my Sunday school book. I've taught Sunday school all these years. She said, I get my kids to Sunday school and then my husband hauls them off for about a month. And then I get them back one time and he hauls them off to ball games and race car events and rodeos. And I'm not meddling with your rodeos and all, but I think you need to go to church first. And she said, I've quit. She got to cry and she told my mom how much she loved her. And when she was completely wound down like a toy that you wind up, and there was no more sounds, I heard my dad. He said, Irene, Sister Irene, if you love me like you say you do, and if you love this church and you love God like you say you do, he said, I've got one request to make of you. And it's easy, it's simple, but I'm asking you, it's my petition, grant me one favor. She said, well, tell me what it is. My dad said, if you will take this book back and teach that Sunday school lesson one more Sunday. I was in the next room and I thought, man, what's the difference in quitting today
Man, get it off of the books.
Dr. Lahr said, give it up. One more time. I heard her. She said, it's violating what I came here to do. But she said, I meant what I said about you and I respect you. And she said, if you want me to teach that class one more Sunday, I'll do it one more Sunday. But Monday, I'm done. That was the end. She walked out and left. I forgot it. But the rest of the story is, when she got up Sunday morning to go teach that class one more time, Bill came walking in there. He said, honey, do I have a suit? She said, where are you going? He said, I need a clean white shirt. She said, where are you going? He said, what about my shoes? Hey, she said, I'll shine those shoes. Where are you going? He said, I was thinking just last night, for all these years, you've been going that way, and I've been going that way. It's time for this stuff to stop. She said, what do you mean? He said, I'm going to church with you today. Hey, girls, get ready. We're going to church with your mother today. My God said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I dare you to preach just one more time. I dare you to get in that choir just one more time. I dare you to go to that prayer room one more time. I dare you to live for God just one more day. See, I didn't know all this stuff. Sister Mangan, you know where I used to sit. I was sitting as far back as you could get. And I put everybody in front of me I could get in front of me so those preachers couldn't shoot at me. I felt like everybody that got up there was leveled off on me. I was sitting right in the back. Up in the corner, bashful and timid, poor self-esteem, low self-image. When I saw that door open and Bill Abercrombie walk in there, I said, oh my God, this is what went on in my heart. I said, I'm not believing this. Her name, as I told you, was Irene. You picked a fine time to leave me, Irene. If it hadn't been for my dad and his wisdom. I wish to God I could hide behind this pulpit or hide behind the cross right now. And God could tell you, hey, whatever you've been doing, just do it one more time. My heart, I thought, was going to quit beating. I watched Bill walk in. Their oldest girl was the high school beauty queen. I watched her walk in. They feel that pew. Irene left them sitting there and went and taught her class. I was close enough behind them that I could hear them. When she got back, he said, man, why didn't you tell me how good this man teaches? Why didn't you tell me about this music? She said, I tried to. I heard all this going on. When church was over, he went to the altar. He was back that night and got baptized in the water in Jesus. Brother Arnold, hell's tried to get me to quit many, many times. Sometimes I can't even get my key people to pray with me. I know exactly how Jesus felt when he said, can't you do it just 1 hour? Just one. And they was asleep before he could get out of their presence with his physical body. I was in that prayer room not long ago. And I said, God, I believe it's just you and me today. Am I doing any good? Am I doing any good? Hey, is your hand still on me? I just need a little reassuring. Brother Mitchell, I got up and walked out of that prayer room and got in my car. It was early. I needed a shave. God knows I didn't look like a preacher. I started home. And I looked at my register. I needed gasoline. I started pulling into a quick serve. And this is going on in my mind. I said, man, I never stop here. What am I stopping here for? I walked in there about half disgusted. I'd prayed by myself. I walked in there and the little girl, I could tell that she was afraid. And there was two or three police officers in there and another crowd of people. Come to find out, she had just been robbed with a gun at gunpoint. I'm coming from prayer wondering if God's still with me and just where we are in all this process. I don't know what made me do it. It was like I couldn't help it. They were all just standing there kind of startled. And I looked that woman in the face that was at the cash register. I said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? She jumped.
And she got a funny look on her face. And tears started streaming down her face. She said, "No, I have not. But my God, I need it. I need it. I need the Holy Ghost." I looked over at that great big old double-jointed policeman. And I was just about to speak to him. And he said, "No. No." He said, "I know who you are." I said, "No, you don't." He said, "Oh, yes, I do." He said, "You're the pastor, Treadway." I said, "I don't look like a preacher." He said, "You don't have to look like one." He said, "I know you." He said, "I guard your house every night." He said, "I watch that house every night. I make trips by there that I'm not required to make just to make sure your place is okay." And he said, "I'm just like the little lady you spoke to. I need God." And tears started streaming down his face. "I need God. I need the Holy Ghost." I was about to pick a fine time to walk out, Lucille. Somebody said, "Why are you using the feminine name?" Because if you quit, you're a sissy. You're a coward! Don't you quit. God's got His hand on this church. God's got us destined for revival. And it's not a time to quit. Hey, we can't quit. We're in. And we've got to ride this thing out. God knows. God knows where we are. And don't you forget, hell knows more about you than you think he does. He knows your tender spot. Hey, he touched me just before I came here. Two of those best families I've got. About willing to quit over a bunch of bunk.
Yeah, absolutely. It's always bunk.
But I'm not going to quit. Hey, I've got a heavenly calling on me. I know who I am. I know where God put me. And I'm not about to quit. I'm going to hang in there and see this project out. Hallelujah. Elijah, you can keep standing. I'm closing. Elijah was under that juniper tree. He was diseased with the quits. It just startled me to see how he butchered up those false prophets and was scared, afraid of Jezebel. One little old whorish woman backed him in a corner.
And God said, hey, man. Elijah said, I'm by myself. God said, oh, no. There's 7,000 that's never bowed a knee to Baal. It's not a time to quit. It's a time to proclaim. It's not a time to walk out. It's a time to herald His name, to shout the victory, to keep on doing what we're doing. Can I go just a little longer? Sit down. The enemy will try to get you to quit any way he can. He'll try to get you to quit over finances. I called my wife in my second building program. I was running out of money for about 2 months, paying bills on Friday by mail and covering them on Monday. And I know it's against the law, but you got to do what you got to do. You heard what the radio preacher said, didn't you? He's preaching against adultery and fornication and sensual and sexual sins. Talking about how you'll go to hell over it. And he got screaming and ranting and hollering and said, don't sin, don't sin, don't sin. But he said, my God, if you do sin right. Boy, you folks are slow. You didn't catch it. Please don't be a homosexual, was what he was saying, for you slow people. Go ahead and laugh. It's all right. The blunder I made was when I called my wife. Boy, I've learned, if I haven't learned anything in the last 33 years at Beaumont, I've learned one thing. There's some things you don't tell your wife. I called her and I told her, I said, we're bankrupt. She said, at what stage of bankruptcy? I said, the only thing left to do is to just publicly announce it. She went out of her mind. She said, you got to be joking. I said, yeah. I said, I've run aground. The church treasurer is aground. The building funds are aground. And we can't finish the building. And the roof on the first building is leaking. I guarantee you, in the back of that church, we had 30 pans trying to catch the water. And she said, where do we go from here? I said, I have no earthly idea. I called her a couple hours later. She said, what's going on now? I said, pack your bags as fast as you can. Pack the bags for the kids. She said, you leaving? Are you resigning?
I said, no, we're going on an extended vacation. She said, I believe that you have lost your ever-loving mind. 2 hours ago, we're bankrupt. The church is. The building fund. And I guess you are too, the way I know you. And now we're going on vacation. She said, how in the name of Jesus Christ can we go on vacation? I said, don't worry about it. I'm a mystery man. What she didn't know, Mike Williams, is in that 2 hours, I had been with the chief boss. And you know what I told him? I said, you know, an hour ago, I claim this is my church, but it ain't mine no more. It's yours. Why don't you give it up today? That's not your church. That's God's church. And that's not your ministry. It's God's ministry. She said, you're serious about this vacation, aren't you? I said, hey, you don't even know how serious. She said, everything's worked out. I said, no. She said, what you gonna do when you get back? And I said, it's not mine to worry about. I said, I was all goofed up. I said, I thought that this was my church. And I said, it's not, it's his. And God's church appears to me to be bankrupt. And I said, I'm not going to stay here and face the music. I'm going off and have a good time. We're headed to the Smoky Mountains. I called home. We was gone all through the weekend. I called home on Monday. At that point in time, we was taking in probably $5,000 or $6,000 a week. That's all. I called home. I called home and the secretary, a very low-key, introvertish, mossback, cantankerous kind of guy. I said, how's finances? He said, wow, you ain't gonna believe it. I said, man, tell me, what happened? He said, while you've been gone, as a matter of fact, he said, I think you might ought to leave more often. I said, hey man, don't put me on like that. Tell me what you're going to say. He said, while you've been gone, he said, we took in $14,000 in one offering. I said, wow. He said, don't wow yet. I said, what you mean don't wow yet? He said, man, we took in $65,000 more.
took in almost as much money the weekend I was gone as we took in a year. The enemy likes for you to think that this is your church. And it's your problem. Hey, I'm serving notice on him. I don't own this thing. I just worship here. Hey, I'm just a part of it. It's his church. The revival is his. The bank account is his. The success of it is his. Everything about it is his. Nudge your buddy. Say, hey, buddy. If you've got the quits, get over it. My. Come on, let's give Jesus a big praise offering. Why don't you shout a little bit? Why don't you talk in tongues a little?